The viral success of a Glasgow postie called Nathan Evans and his sea shanties was another surprising twist to lockdown life. The original video was viewed over 6 million times on TikTok alone and inspired a flurry of community spirit, with other social media users adding harmonies, instrumentation, remixing it with dubstep, drum and bass, reggae and metal. Ronan Keaton and Gary Barlow even did their own version. But there is more to sea shanties than meets the eye. In this video, I am going to explore their fascinating and dark history. The sea shanty, whose name is proposed to come from the French chanter, to sing, first gained popular recognition in the 18th century, although it's thought that the genre could predate the records by hundreds of years. No one knows the exact origin, but it's thought that sea shanties are inspired by British folk and African American work songs sung by slaves. Before most of us worked at a desk and could just pop on our headphones and listen to our motivational music of choice, most of the population worked in heavy, team-based labour. Working songs were used to motivate and coordinate these tasks, and merchant sailors and nautical workers were no exception. To understand the genre, we need to understand the conditions from which it was born. A merchant sailor's life was dangerous and grueling. Seamen lived in cramped conditions next to disease-carrying rats, had low pay, worked in bad weather so were often cold and wet, and often had a poor diet which caused malnutrition and scurvy caused by a lack of vitamin C. Many sailors signed up to the job because of poverty without even seeing the boat. At the time, sailors who refused to board could be sentenced to 12 weeks hard labour in jail. Now, I have a fact which really illustrates how terrible the conditions were on the ships. In the 1850s, a prison inspector reported that 3/4 of jailed prisoners in the southwest of England were sailors who refused to sail on unseaworthy, dangerous, or inadequately manned vessels. People chose hard labour in jail rather than working on a ship. Even on well-run ships, mistakes could cost the whole crew their life, so the ship's officers kept strict discipline on board, and that doesn't mean a good talking to. Punishments include being tarred and feathered. Yes, that means pouring sometimes hot tar over a person, then either throwing feathers at them or forcing them to roll in the feathers. Or being keel-hauled, a punishment which would, at best, permanently maim. This was enforced by tying a rope around the victim, swinging them overboard, and dragging them behind or underneath the ship. Flogging was the most common punishment, with either a knotted rope or, if you were unlucky, a cat-o'-nine-tail, which was a sort of whip made of 9 knotted cotton ropes. And, of course, a seaman found guilty of mutiny would be hanged. But amongst all this horror, where does the sea shanty come in? They were vital in coordinating tasks, in promoting team spirit, keeping morale high, and helping sailors express and process the emotional impact of their grueling lifestyles. For the ship's officers, this would mean a reduction in mistakes, in mutiny, and therefore punishments. So what makes up a sea shanty and how does it work? Well, the key to a sea shanty is rhythm, and there are different rhythms for different tasks. For example, the capstan shanty. The capstan was the machine that brought up the anchor. Wooden poles were attached to a central axle, and sailors would push these poles in a smooth, circular motion. Therefore, a more lyrical, smoother sea shanty was needed. The most famous shanty, Drunken Sailor, was a short hull shanty. Designed for tasks requiring quick pulls over a relatively short amount of time, it had a very particular structure, with 4 pulls per verse. In Scotland, the 18th century dreg song from the Firth of Forth, a Scottish estuary, was used on 3-man boats that collected oysters by dredging. 2 men would row and another man would operate the dredge, which was an iron frame with a net attached that would drag along the sea floor. To work effectively, The boats had to keep a constant speed. Too fast and the dreg would bounce and lift up off the ocean floor, and too slow and the nets wouldn't open fully. So to keep this constant speed, the fishermen designed a song with an asymmetric rhythm. The dredge operator would sing a 5-syllable call, matching the effort it would take for the oars to pull through the water. The rowers would then respond with a 3-syllable phrase, matching the effort it would take to bring the oars round in the air. This was so effective at scraping the oysters off the sea floor that the fishermen believed the songs would charm the oysters from the sea bed. At the start of the 18th century, fishermen were collecting 30 million oysters a year. Side note, this was actually pretty short-sighted and decimated to the oyster population. The annual catch fell to 9 million by 1867 and then to 60,000 by 1877. The dredging industry slowly declined and died. But in 1957, the Firth of Forth oysters were declared extinct. Maybe the dreg songs worked too well. Some other features of the sea shanty might point to why they've been quite so popular on social media. Like much of the social media we consume, a sea shanty is a short, concise format for telling a story. They follow the classic format of an earworm. I did a more in-depth video on this, and if you're interested, I'll link it in at the end. But in short, they're traditionally designed to be simple songs with a rhythm, which makes it really catchy and really memorable. And it's not just the simplicity that makes it catchy. They're really easy to sing, following a small range and focusing really on rhythm, meaning you don't have to be a great singer to make it sound good. And this feature also makes it easy to remix with different genres, fueling the creativity that has unfolded around the revival. And during this hugely isolating time for people, perhaps it's not surprising that we've had a resurgence in community song. Chanties tell stories of people working together through adversity. In fact, the song that inspired the viral craze, "Soon May the Wellerman Come," speaks of richer, better days ahead. Of course, we are facing different challenges today as opposed to the 18th century. However, the sentiment still rings true, as most of us are hoping for better days ahead after the pandemic ends. However, it seems this song has a dark history as well. In the early 19th century, the Weller brothers had a whaling station in New Zealand. Their employees were known as the Wellermen. Although most people would call the Wellerman song a shanty because of its shanty rhythm, it's actually technically a cutting-in song, a cousin of the shanty. The cutting-in song is a working song that helps nautical workers get through yet another undesirable task. Mostly sung on land, the cutting song was designed to accompany the whale's slaughter, stripping of the whale carcass, and boiling the blubber. Although foul-smelling, the whale oil was used in soap, mechanical lubricant and candles at the time, and was very valuable. Ambergris, a grey waxy substance formed from a secretion of the bile duct in the intestines of the whale, was sold as a fixative and perfume, and whalebone was a sturdy but flexible material that could be used in brushes, corsets and umbrellas. From 1833, the Weller brothers began using ships to sell provisions to whalers at sea. The song's lyrics tell us of how the crew hope for the Wellerman to come to bring us sugar, tea, and rum. According to the New Zealand Folk Song website, the workers weren't even paid in money, but were paid in clothing, rum, and tobacco. The working conditions were poor. In the song, the lyrics tell us how the workers hoped one day to take our leave and go. However, the Wellers expanded into a diverse array of industries, including timber, potatoes, dried fish, Maori artifacts, and even the preserved heads of tattooed Maori people. Yes, you heard it right. Preserving heads as a death rite was a normal tradition for high-ranking Maoris. However, the industry got a little more grisly in the 19th century. When demand became high, the Wellerman helped make heads to order by tattooing and killing slaves. Although the whaler business was initially successful, the whale population collapsed and forced the whalers to declare bankruptcy after only 10 years. But there is a nicer point to take away. Over a decade ago, oysters were once again discovered in the Firth of Forth, and in 2020 it was reported that whales are making an astonishing comeback around the world. Perhaps this is the final reason that sea shanties have become so popular. They remind us that after tough times, we can heal and recover. If you like these episodes, then thank the Beth Roars patrons. We could not make these episodes without them. So, to all the patron community, including the amazing Ultimate Roars, whose names are up on the screen, thank you for making all this possible and allowing us to dig a little bit deeper into the history and science of music and sound. If you would like to learn a little bit more about becoming a patron, you can at patreon.com/BethRoar, and I will see you in the next one. Bye! Rawr.